Today on the Rock Newman Show, the apple doesn't fall far from the tree. When Congressman Bill Clay of Missouri stepped down from office, he was succeeded by his son, Lacy Clay. Father and son discuss 45 years of power, politics, and time spent in Washington, D.C., plus Bill Clay Sr.'s new book about Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. 45 years, that's how many current Congressman Lacy Clay and his father, former Congressman Bill Clay, have represented Missouri's 1st District. It's an impressive legacy, and they are here to talk about it. Former Congressman Bill Clay, welcome to the Rock Newman Show, and
thank
the
you.
Son didn't fall far from the tree. Lacy Clay, thank you so much for joining us here today. It is so timely having you guys. We are 3 weeks ahead of the midterm elections for 2014, a very important time for the country. Your communities, particularly Ferguson, has been the subject of intense scrutiny by the world these days. I want to see if I can frame this conversation in the following way. In 1963, 51 years ago, Bill Clay, you were arrested and put in jail for 105 days for protesting inequities and inequality in the St. Louis area. Congressman William Clay, you now are at the forefront of a subject matter that has lit this country up, the death of Michael Brown in Ferguson. Congressman Bill Clay, I'd like if you could share the similarities and the difference 50 years later.
Well, let me start by saying that in St. Louis, we had the Jefferson Bank confrontation, which was in 63. It was started 2 days after the March on Washington. And one of the reasons that we did not have the explosion, the uprising when Dr. King was murdered a couple of years later was because of that confrontation that we had at the Jefferson Bank. It was a massive kind of thing, just like the Ferguson thing. And we had certain demands that we were making of the community because I had done a study while I was on the Board of Aldermen that showed, it was called The Anatomy of an Economic Murder, and it showed that major corporations in St. Louis and small businesses were not hiring our people. And that's what the Jefferson, including the banks, that's what that was all about. But after 4 years of, and this is how long the Jefferson Bank confrontation lasted, after 4 years and hundreds of us going to jail, 500 went to jail that they recorded, and after that they stopped making arrests. Yeah. They would take you in, detain you, hold you for 2 hours and let you go. They didn't make, so it was thousands of people.
Yeah.
That got arrested. But the reason we didn't have the uprising was by the time King was killed, we had broken that cycle of unemployment for blacks. We had put blacks in all of the major corporations, in the downtown department stores, in white-collar jobs with the insurance agencies, in every job possible. Plus, we had elected blacks citywide. We'd elected blacks as comptroller of the city, as recorder of deeds, licensed collectors. We had elected about 10 people to the city council. And so we had put in place the kinds of things that they're demanding in St. Louis County now.
Okay, see? Now, before we get to now, let's just go back, because I want my 2014 listening audience to understand and appreciate the commitment of those who were in the midst and the heat of the civil rights movement. You got arrested and stayed and ended up going to jail for 105 days.
118, but we won't quibble over 13 days.
More
than one arrest, too,
yeah.
You know.
And so tell us about that in jail experience that you had protesting for fairness.
Well, let me put it this way. You see, the establishment in St. Louis thought they had divided the community between the professional blacks and the blacks who were striving to become middle class, work more decent pay. And what they found out was we were so insistent on getting these jobs for black kids that they couldn't count on the professional blacks, because when they met with them, the professional blacks would say to them, "We support what's going on with these young people."
So the attempt was divided and conquered, and it didn't work that time.
Yeah, because they said, "We are sending our children off to schools all around the country, and when they graduate, they don't come home because they can't find a job in this town." Mm-hmm. So the doctors took a day to walk in the picket lines. Yeah. The lawyers took a day to walk there. The principals of the schools. It became a community, mm-hmm. a whole community. And so they knew that they had better negotiate with the young voices now that were demanding a hell of a lot more than what the old voices thought they could get.
Mm-hmm. So this was a struggle. Again, let's go back. I kind of want to tap into that time that you spent in jail. Were those scary times?
Well, they weren't scary, because every night I could look out the window and see my family, my wife, and hundreds of people down there saying, "Let them out of jail." Uh-huh. And they would be waving up there. And so we knew we had support outside. So it wasn't scary. And the inmates inside were on our side. Mm-hmm. Because when we went into jail, we did a lot of things. The lawyers that went with us helped to get some of them out, because they were there because they couldn't pay fines. Mm-hmm. The teachers that went in set up schooling to teach these guys how to read and write, and they were on our side. Yeah. So it was a community thing. Mm-hmm.
And Lacy, 50 years later, now in Ferguson, your dad talks about the lid was held on any explosive kind of situation when Martin Luther King got killed, because there was a sense of real improvement in 1968, 5 years after your dad first went to jail. The lid didn't stay on in Ferguson. The sense is there is a lack of justice, there is a lack of job, there's a lack of education. Talk to us about Ferguson 2014, what's going on there now.
Well, let me first of all say that, you know, I realize, Rock, that I stand on the shoulders of giants. And from my dad and others in his generation who made it possible for us to progress as a country. And if you look at the progress that has been made over the past 50 or 60 years, it's been remarkable. But take us to 2014, August the 9th, in Ferguson, Missouri, and that was a flashpoint or a breaking point for the African-American community in St. Louis. And when you think about the conditions that African Americans had to live under in St. Louis County, mm-hmm. with a police state that levied a poor people's tax on basically black people, from traffic stops.
I was gonna say, what do you mean?
From minor offenses, and it could be local ordinances, it could be city ordinances in the city of Ferguson. Knowing that these people did not have the resources to cover those fines, be it a traffic stop, and then it just accelerated from there, because you would have warrants issued when people didn't show up for court. And it's been well documented since the tragic incident in August. And looking at 1963 versus 2014, St. Louis has made a lot of progress, but we still have a long way to go when it comes to all St. Louis's living under one system of justice. And that is what we are striving for. 2 days after Michael Brown tragically lost his life at the hands of a police officer, I made a personal appeal to Attorney General Eric Holder to begin an investigation of the tragic incident, and to look at a second type of investigation, looking at patterns and practices of the Ferguson, Missouri Police Department, as well as other police departments in St. Louis County. And we are pursuing that now, and it culminated in his visit.
What impact did his visit have, Eric Holder's visit have
It certainly demonstrated to my constituents in St. Louis that the full force and the resources of the federal government are there to seek justice for Leslie McSpadden and Michael Brown Sr., the parents of Michael Brown. And I have made a commitment to the parents and told them I will seek justice with them. To the full extent of the resources available at the federal level. Now there is another parallel investigation going on at the state level, which I have no confidence in, run by the St. Louis County Prosecutor Bob McCullum. He has a track record of not indicting police officers in questionable shootings, especially when the victims are African American. And I don't believe there will be an indictment in this case at the state level. I do have a lot of confidence in the two parallel investigations being conducted by the U.S. Department of Justice. And my office is working with the Community Relations Program of the Department of Justice, as well as their COPS program, to reform the way police agencies interact with the African American community.
You know, that is a powerful and strong indictment coming from a sitting U.S. congressman to state that you do not have confidence in a state investigation, that there is going to be fairness in a black man's murder. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me why you feel so strongly about that?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball, so I cannot predict the future, but I do know past practices of this prosecutor. Mm-hmm. And I do know that whenever there has been an egregious case like this, or with similar facts, this prosecutor has always sided with the police. And then when you look at the way he is prosecuting this case, he is dumping the evidence on the grand jury without presenting a prosecution. Now, and you and I know that in this country, prosecutors throughout the country could indict a ham sandwich.
That's the cliche, that's actually rather true.
Right, and so for him not to be pursuing a prosecution tells me everything, that he's not sincere about bringing justice for the Brown family or for the African-American community in St. Louis County.
When you look at the facts, according to what research I've done, Bob McCullough, the prosecutor, who is handling this case, his father was killed by a police officer killed by a black man years ago. His mother, brother, sister, cousin, and other family members have been a part of the police. For the life of me, I don't understand how one might say with a straight face that you can maintain objectivity. Now, okay, but he does it. So then, the governor of the state has the ability to make a change. Why hasn't Governor Jay Nixon made a change, or what's his position as we speak?
Well, my dad can share with you some of the history of McCullough, and I'll let him do that.
I would like for our audience to understand
let
that.
Let me answer your question about Governor Nixon. There was a state of emergency about a week after the initial shooting, the governor had the power then under the state constitution to appoint a special prosecutor, and he did not. And now that he has lifted the state of emergency, you no longer have that in accordance with state law to appoint a special prosecutor. So he would have to reinstitute a state of emergency, or Mr. McCullough would have to voluntarily withdraw from the prosecutor.
Doesn't seem like that's going to happen.
I don't think it will.
You have a history with Bob McCullough.
Well, as I recall the incident, and people keep saying that a black man killed his father, he may or may not have been. As I recall what happened on that day, McCollum's father was a police officer, was driving into his driveway when he heard on his radio, not the police radio, that there was a shootout in the public housing project. Now, like John Wayne, he's off duty, he backs out of his driveway and drives down to the housing project and engages with dozens of other police officers shooting at this one particular black man. We don't know who shot him. It must have been thousands of shots down there. The black man didn't have that many bullets, so he could have been killed by another police officer. Mm-hmm. So that's the point that I wanted to make about Bob McCollum's father. The other point I want to elaborate on him and his tax on poor people. There are about 35 or 40 small communities out in St. Louis County. See, St. Louis and St. Louis County are two separate entities.
Mm-hmm. And you guys from your congressional seat have represented all of them?
No, we represent, I represented half of the city and part of the county.
Okay.
He now, under the new district, he represents the whole city and part of the county where Ferguson is.
Which includes
is.
Jefferson. Yeah,
right. But mm-hmm. It's about 25, about 30 or 40 little small communities. When I say small, mm-hmm. I'm talking about 700, 800 people, 1,000 people, and they got their little communities. They don't have a tax base. They don't have any businesses there. So they issue tickets, traffic tickets, to pay for the police department. All of them got their own little police department. Mm-hmm. And so to pay the police salaries and to pay the mayor and the city council, they gotta have some revenue. So they issue thousands and thousands of tickets. Last study that I saw said 85% of some of their budgets come from traffic tickets. So that's part of the problem. They need to eliminate those small communities and those small police departments.
You know, both you guys are politicians that have been, you know, held elected office now for a combined total of 45 plus years. I'm going to ask you to play political scientists here for a moment. The community in Ferguson, overwhelmingly African American. The mayor, city council, and police force, overwhelmingly white. Now, some of those positions, not the police force, but the people who ultimately hire the city council, are elected positions. Why is it that in a community that's overwhelmingly African American, you have people who aren't representing of the population of the community?
Let me take a shot at it first. It has a lot to do with the timing of the municipal elections, which are an odd number years in April. In November of even number years, when we have a general election for Congress or president, there is no problem with turnout out of Ferguson and other parts of St. Louis County. I get about 55 to 56% of the African American vote out of Ferguson to turn out for those elections.
So folks in Ferguson vote.
Yes, they vote. And by April of odd-numbered years, there's not much interest. Now, that's not an excuse. Mm-hmm. So what I have recommended to the state legislators who represent that area, is that they propose a law to actually change the election date for those municipal elections from April of odd-numbered years to November of even-numbered years.
Now, is that being fought by your Republican opponents?
I'm sure they will fight it, but we will let the debate take its place.
Let me speak in behalf of that. During an off year, if there's nobody running for county election, nobody running for state election, nobody running for national election, most people don't even know there's an election because there's no television, no commercials, nothing. Yeah. It's just a local community of about 20,000 people, and nobody's putting out any literature. In order to get people out to vote, you have to either advertise heavily or you go door to door to get them. There's no incentive for the present elected officials to let anybody know there is an election.
Another example of that, and it's a terrible example, is that you have a school district called Ferguson-Florissant School District who had their last election in April of 2013. It's 80% African-American school district, and they just got their first African-American board, school board member. They only have one out of seven members of that board. And it's long overdue that the residents get more active in their local politics.
And within the last couple of weeks, there's it's drawn national attention. Again, there was another murder of a black man by a police officer in St. Louis. What details have emerged about that? You heard initially that the police officer was being shot at by this gentleman. Has that any factual information been shared on that yet?
Here's what I have shared with Senators McCaskill, Governor Nixon, Mayor Slay, who is the mayor of the city of St. Louis, and our state attorney general, is that I will call in the U.S. Department of Justice to look at the St. Louis Metropolitan Police Department also. Because since August the 9th and the shooting of Michael Brown, the St. Louis City Police have shot and killed two African-American individuals in what I consider to be questionable shootings. In the first instance was a mentally challenged young man with a pocket, a butter knife in his hand, and police unloaded about 16 times into his body, unnecessary. And then the second one was this most recent one, a Mr. Myers, who is in a video again in a sandwich shop getting a sandwich, and 10 minutes later, through his interactions with the police, he winds up dead. And so those are both questionable shootings in my mind. And it's time for it to stop, to cease and desist, because we cannot have police who are supposed to serve and protect communities being on edge and having young black males who interact with police winding up dead.
What do both of you attribute to what seems to be the proliferation of this? You know, I don't want to use cliches here, but it's like every week somewhere in this country, there's a innocent black person, or you know, there's a black person armed by an apparatus from the state. What's happened in this climate? You know, again, in doing some of the research, I saw some of your challenges, Congressman Clay, to the Tea Party. Some of your comments about the Tea Party, which some people had some serious criticism of you for. Has there been, since the election of Barack Obama in 2008, him taking office in 2009, do you attribute him becoming president to what seems to be a more hostile environment, or has that hostile environment always existed?
Well, I think it's a combination of both. First of all, there's a substantial number of people, and most of them residing in the 11 southern states, that don't think they lost the Civil War. They don't think Robert E. Lee signed the surrender. And so if you look back into history, you will see that there's always this element. With the election of President Obama, they seem to have come out of the closet, so to speak. I mean, when you can have a member of the U.S. House of Representatives to say in a State of the Union address that a president lied openly. Yeah. I mean, that's total disrespect. And then the next week, he raises $2 million for his campaign fund. It tells you something about the mentality of a certain number of people in this country. And they're still fighting the Civil War. They still think that they have a right to own people. And they resent the kind of progress that my son talked about that has been made. If you look at what's happening with our Supreme Court and our Negro representative on the court, they are trying in every way possible to take back all of the progress that we have, as a people, have made in the last 60 years in this country. So yes, it's two things. It's some people have never given up, and other people are saying we aren't going to give up. Yeah.
Also, when you think about our criminal justice system in this country and how it interacts with African American people and people of color in general, we have the highest incarceration rate in the world. We execute more people than any other country in the world. We have as many on death row as any other country. And so when you talk about, has it, since the election of President Obama, has it become more prevalent? For sure. It certainly has. But then you see the president and Eric Holder looking at these minimum sentence requirements, looking at changing the way the criminal justice system interacts with people of color in this country. And that's good. And so we are hearing, getting backlash from that, from people like the Tea Party, especially those who question the president's place of birth. That is purely racist in its tone and the way they have acted towards this man who is the leader of the free world.
Yeah, it's an interesting term you use, president of the free world. It brings me to this point I wanted to talk to you about. Many years ago, Congressman Clay, when you were in office, you went to Cuba, and you met and spent time with Fidel Castro. Your son Lacy says President Obama is the president of the free world. You know, people point to Fidel Castro as an example of a world not being free and his people sort of being in bondage. I'd like for you to elaborate on your experience, just sort of your personal interaction with Fidel Castro, and also, please, what the U.S. policy, the right and wrong of the U.S. policy as it relates to Cuba.
Well, first of all, let me say that impression about him being oppressive to his people is coming from the outside, not from the inside. I was there for a couple of days. I met with him often, a fabulous individual, highly intelligent, speaks a number of languages. The first night I was there on a congressional delegation. We had a meeting with him that started like maybe 8 o'clock at night. We went to his office. His office is in a large building with a circular driveway. There was no fence there, no gate. One car there apparently had some armed security in the driveway. We go inside, was no evidence of people like our White House, where you got this big fence, you got a tank there, you got automatic weapons, you got hundreds of guards around the White House. Apparently, that wasn't the case there. And then after talking to this man, then we visited throughout the country. But after talking to him, he said, you know, when I took over, he said, the illiteracy rate in this country was 90%. He said, now it's less than 10%. He said the unemployment was 80-some%. Everybody's working now. He said the only people who worked before the revolution were people who were prostitutes, who were working in the casinos and gamblers and all of that. He said, everybody works now. And so, you know, then we went on a tour with him the next day. And this is a good example. It was a congressman from New York City. And we were riding on the bus. Castro was talking through an interpreter because he refused to speak in English, even though he's fluent in that language. He was talking through the interpreter. when the congressman from New York City interrupted him and said, no, wait a minute, we're going through this area, all of these big houses where the rich people used to live, and you stole their houses, you kicked them out. Castro told the driver, stop right here. We all got off the bus, we went inside. It was a mansion. It must have been, Castro said, it must be 40 rooms in this building. He says, before I took over, two people lived here. He said, I didn't kick them out. They're still here. But 39 other families live in this house. Yeah. Now, to me, that was impressive. I mean, the rich shouldn't live like that, and the people, rest of the people live in tents and caves. Mm-hmm. So the congressman from New York had to apologize.
You know, the justification for the embargo on Cuba, the trade policy, has been what has been Castro being accused of human rights violations. United States government, that's the policy. Yet, the United States government engages with communist China, who I don't think anyone could ever accuse a Castro government of being nearly as having kind of egregious human rights violation of the Chinese. How is that ever reconciled?
You can't. Rock, we fought in Vietnam, the communist regime. We lost 58,000 Americans in that battle. The cry was, if we don't stop communism here, if we lose this war, all of Asia is going to fall. Cambodia, Laos, Thailand. Well, not only did it fall, the Vietnamese were shooting at our airplanes as we tried to escape. Now, do you know what the reality of that is? Vietnam is one of our major trading partners right now. So, you know, this is a phony issue about human rights. I mean, our record on human rights is horrible. Do you know that lynching in this country, that one year, every 36 hours, there was a black man for a whole year lynched in this country? Do you know that we had the Tuskegee experiment? You know about that.
Oh, absolutely.
Where we had 400 black men that they thought they were being treated for some unknown disease, and they weren't being treated. They were being watched. They all had syphilis, and they weren't being treated. They were being watched to see how the human being reacted to syphilis. And then they went and spread it that back home to their wives, to their girlfriends. I mean, this is... You talk about human rights.
You know, let me also.
If I can ask this, again, in doing research, I came across a comment from Rand Paul, where he said the United States government had 900 military bases, as many as 900 military bases in 130 different countries, and he was really challenged on that. Some fact checkers came back and said, you know what, it's arguable that both of those comments were true. And I want to ask you now, as a sitting member of Congress, what, if anything, what impact, what input do you have on that kind of foreign policy that comes out of this government? Because they said that's not about self-defense, that's about empire building.
And that's accurate. But let me say, in my first year in Congress in 2001, I was able to also visit Fidel Castro in Cuba. And my dad makes a good point about how he's raised literacy rates and provided health care to people. He also demonstrated to us that he exports doctors throughout the world. He trains doctors in Cuba and then exports them to other countries to provide meaningful health care. He also pointed out when we were there, this was right after 9/11, that he provided his airfields to U.S. planes to land during the emergency right after 9/11, and he provided our State Department with sensitive information about those terrorist attacks. And so when you think about the policy of how we have helped, he has made it through the existence of 10 U.S. presidents. He's outlived most of them. And when you think about our foreign policy towards Cuba, it emanates from South Florida. And those are people that have held a grudge, and we should not be conducting ourselves as a country and allowing one section of the country to dictate our foreign policy to a neighbor.
Let me say, the policy is so screwed up, and so prejudiced, that if a Cuban sets foot on American soil, we keep him. We turn boats away from the rest of the Caribbean, from Jamaica and Haiti and those places, turn them around. Now, that goes back to in Florida, where you've got all of these Cuban, they call them expatriates. They stole everything that wasn't nailed down when they left. They brought the whole university of the Cuban city there to Florida. They brought everything. And so here we got a different policy on people coming from Cuba than any other place in the Caribbean.
Let me also answer your initial question about the 900 military bases and building the empire. I think we learned under a former president, George W. Bush, that we could not spread democracy throughout the world. We could not be the ones to promote democracy. And when you think about China and Russia, they kind of rub it in our faces with incidents like Ferguson and say, oh, look at the big promoters of democracy. How can they be, they are hypocritical when they have their own issues in their own country, and they're correct. But 900 bases, what you are seeing is a downsizing of our military. And I've met with Secretary Hagel, Secretary of Defense, as well as others in the administration, and I agree with them that we have to have a orderly downsizing, because let's face it, we don't need all of these bases around the country. We fight wars differently than boots on the ground. Right now, there's all of this technology, there's these very expensive jets, fighter jets, as well as drones that the military uses, unmanned drones. And so it's a little different in the way.
To the viewer who is watching and listening to your comments here, I can imagine that we might get a letter that says, you just had two people on there that served in Congress for 45 plus years and they're anti-American. How would you respond to that?
I am a patriotic American. I love my country. I am, that is who I am. But I know that we can perfect this union and make it a better for all Americans and make it equal justice. Make sure that all Americans come under one system of justice, and that's one of my goals.
Well, it would be no problem for me to justify my ability to say that I am all about America. I served 32 years in the Congress. I was elected with Richard Nixon, and I left with Clinton. During the 32 years, I passed 295 bills that became law. That means they passed the Senate and were signed by the president. And let me tell you about some of those bills and my Americanism. The Family and Medical Leave Act was mine. Hatch Act reform for federal employees was mine.
When you say mine, you mean you authored those bills?
Authored them and managed them on the floor of Congress. Mm-hmm. 5-year vesting in your pension. Transfer, portability of it. You can take your pension now from one job to the other. You don't have to be tied for a lifetime to a job that you don't want. COBRA, where you can take your insurance, your hospitalization with you afterwards. I mean, a whole list of things. I passed all of Clinton's education bills, including 100,000 extra teachers for the classroom to reduce class size. You can go through my whole list of 295 bills, some of them legendary. I mean, so I know what you can do as a member of Congress, and especially if you love your country. And I love my country with all of the defects that it's had. I still love it because I believe that at some point we're going to get it right.
Okay. You love your country. You have completed a book on someone you referred to earlier in the show as a Negro, I think, on the Supreme Court. And it wouldn't take a rocket scientist to figure out we might be talking about Clarence Thomas.
You said a Negro.
Okay.
Yes.
So, now, that one might say that's inflammatory rhetoric. And one, I'd like to understand, what was your motivation in writing the book, and what are your, from whence comes the, what I detect as harsh feelings towards Clarence Thomas and his policies and impacts and decisions on the Supreme Court?
First of all, let me say, I am a writer.
Okay.
I've published 6 books, and Clarence Thomas's latest one is just one of the 6. Mm-hmm. And the title of it lets you know my feeling for Clarence Thomas.
And what is the title? What is the title? And when can we get this book?
It'll be out within 30 days. The title is "A Black Knight in Tainted Armor."
Ooh.
And I wrote it because, as a member of Congress, I had jurisdiction over part of the programs that he was in charge of, EEOC in particular. And to look and see what this person has done in terms of taking us back as a race of people to where we were before the civil rights movement.
Okay, so you're talking about, you're talking about his time when he was on the EEOC and some of the policies.
No, I'm talking about his time now as a member of the
okay.
of the Supreme Court and how he is sitting there. Using his vote, the 5th vote with these other 4 conservatives, mm-hmm. To repeal all of the progress that we have made.
Can you give me some examples of that, please?
Well, first of all, let's talk about the Voting Rights Act.
Right.
Here's a man that believes that we ought to, and he voted with the 5-4 decision to say that states, the 9 states that are covered by the Voting Rights Act, don't have to get clearance, pre-clearance from the Justice Department. And you see what's happening. They are doing all kinds of things to keep the black people from voting. He's opposed to affirmative action, and he's demonstrated that in these 5-4 decisions. He's demonstrated that cities now don't have to give contracts with their city monies mm-hmm. on an equal basis. He's also opposed to class action suits. He now makes it necessary because it was 5-4 decision that says that you can't have these class action suits. In other words, if a fire department, if major cities, fire department, police departments are all white in a city, that's 35% to 40% black. Each black has to file individually, challenging that. If a corporation, a major corporation hiring thousands of people, don't have women and blacks in their workforce, even though the demographics of the area is substantial black, Hispanic, or women, they have to file individual cases.
Talk to us about a rather recent decision also on money in politics.
That's horrible. Because now what you're saying is that you can't modify the amount of money that you can spend on a candidate. So you can buy an elected official, and you can't have, cities can't say, well, you can only spend X number of dollars, or you have to report what you spend. This Supreme Court, and that was another 5-4 decision. He's become the 5th vote with these other ignorant, crazy people on the Supreme Court, and I call them that because they are ignorant of what democracy is about. They're crazy because they think they're going to win. I don't think they're going to win, but that's what this man is about. He's opposed to using race as one of the categories for college admission. Now he got into a college because of his race, and now he claims that it stigmatizes him. Affirmative action stigmatizes the recipient. Well, he's crazy because he's been stigmatized since the day he was born in this country. Every black man has. And so for him to argue that affirmative action that got him into college, he never would have got in if it had not been for a policy of affirmative action. And this is what we're facing with this man sitting on the Supreme Court. So yes, I've devoted 375 pages to him, and it hasn't been kind treatment.
Lacy, tell me please, as a active member of Congress, the Supreme Court decision that just came down allows, whether or not it is unions who by and large are thought to support Democratic candidates, or the Koch brothers and many others, to be able to spend money, and as your dad just said, to buy an election. What is the remedy to taking out the vulgarity of money in elected politics, nationally and locally?
The short answer, Rock, is that we are going to have some form of public funding of elections. In other words, allow the candidates to make a choice of whether they want small dollar donations, which accumulate into enough resources to take on well-funded candidates or to fight off well-funded opposition at you. There is a bill that's been introduced in the House by the congressman from Maryland, whose name escapes me now, but it gets us into the arena of public funding, and I would voluntarily do that because I know that I could get the $40, $50 donations, and then have the taxpayers match that, which is basically what public funding of it would be, and then it would also stigmatize those big dollar donors, which is what you want to do, because if we don't address it, then you will have the House and the Senate becoming elitist clubs that will be done by that will be mostly populated by self-funders and the rich. Interest.
And there are those who are concerned that with these Supreme Court decisions and the lack of serious oversight of campaign finance, that this country and electoral politics is headed towards seriously favoring an oligarchy.
Yeah, and let me say about this. The Supreme Court decision says that corporations are people, and you can spend corporate money, I mean, without a vote of the people who own the stock. You can't spend unions, against the law to spend union dues for campaigns. The money that unions spend are voluntarily contributed into a union fund for political purposes, and everybody who donates know that's what it's for. But a union boss can't take the union dues and give anything to him or to any other candidate. So there's a distinct difference. A corporation can take stockholders' money. You own stock, he owns stock, I own stock, without our permission. But a union can't do that. Mm-hmm. So that's the real danger of that decision.
And in the case of the U.S. House of Representatives, the so-called People's House, you are moving, you are putting it out of reach from average Americans who have always been representative of that body. If Citizens United is not addressed, you will have mostly well-to-do people who don't have who are not in touch with the common American experience. And so you will have probably a worse form of government.
You know, you've, as you say, have dedicated over 300 pages in your next book out in 30 days on Clarence Thomas. He certainly has been a lightning rod. He has been someone that has been referred to, especially in the African American community and other progressive places, in not favorable terms. In doing the book, have you uncovered any kind of research that you think helps you to at least understand why he has made some of the decisions that he's made that so often are seen as counterproductive to African American and other minorities?
I've come to the conclusion that, number one, we've got a very sick man on there. We've got a man who hates himself and he hates blackness. I think he's blaming any and everything, his failures, on the fact that he was born black. And, you know, and he makes such idiotic statements, like you've heard him make the statement that government doesn't create jobs, the private sector does. Well, here's a man that's been working for 41 years. 39 of them have been on the government payrolls. He's only worked 2 years for the private sector. That was for Monsanto Chemical. But he was 2 years in the state attorney general's office. He was 3 years in a congressional office. He was 3 years as an appellate judge. He was 4 years at EEOC, 4 years at the Civil Rights Commission, and the last 23 years at the Supreme Court. Now, for him to make a statement that government doesn't create jobs, it sure in the hell did a good job for him. In addition to that, I mean, here's a man that we black folks have said he sold us out all his life. And then when I look at his financial disclosure statement when he was being considered for the Supreme Court, and you have to file one, his net worth was $30,000. That tells you something about a man that's been an attorney for all of them years, worked in all of these jobs, and his net worth was $30,000 in 1991. Woo!
What does that tell you?
It tells me he wasn't well paid. He was probably paid the minimum wage of $7 an hour to sell a whole race of people out.
What, to the both of you, what does black America have to be hopeful for?
I think black America has to really appreciate the fact over these last 6.5 years that we've had somebody over the U.S. Department of Justice like Attorney General Eric Holder, who has tried to reverse, and it is reversing, some of these draconian interactions between our legal justice system and the African American community and communities of color. And we also have to be hopeful about President Obama being there. And giving a different kind of perspective that this country and the world has never seen.
Are you satisfied with Obama's presidency?
Well, I don't think that's the issue in terms of what black people have to hope for. I think what we have to hope for in this country, and it's not just for black people, is that someday we will become the democracy that our founding fathers claimed they were putting together, and that this country that we claim is a Christian country, that Christians at all levels, and I'm talking about from the top down, the religious all the way down will realize that you can't treat a race of people, and in our instance, not just our race, it's the Hispanics and then women as well, you can't treat them like they don't exist, or that they exist only for the benefit of white males, which is what another thing Clarence Thomas voted with them to say that affirmative action is a reverse discrimination against white men.
Tell us the name of that book again and when we can get it.
A Black Knight in Tainted Armor.
Congressman Clay, Congressman Clay,
thank you so much
for joining us
today
at the Rock Newman Show. Folks, that wraps us up for today. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to www.whut.org. I'm Rock Newman. God bless you, and I'll see you the next time.